Welcome to the December 15th special meeting of the Montgomery ISD School Board of Trustees. This is our 5 p.m. meeting. We're going to go ahead and call it to order and open with the Pledge of Allegiance to the United States flags and the Texas flags. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible. Next, we're going to ask, are there any public comments? Thank you. With that, the board will go into closed meeting as mentioned on the agenda to discuss a variety of employment and safety issues and to deliberate the purchase, exchange, or lease value of real property. Thank you. All right, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This is our first try at a new approach to our closed session. So this is the MISD board returning from a special meeting and closed session. To the date is December 15th, 2020. It is now 6:03 p.m. Are there any motions?
I'd like a motion to approve personnel as presented.
There's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? It passes. This meeting is now adjourned. But wait, there's more. Again, as we are working through a new approach to doing our closed session meetings, we are now entering the regular scheduled meeting for the Montgomery ISD School Board on December 15th, 2020. I will now call this meeting to order, and please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible. Are there any public comments at this time? There are no public comments. We'll move forward.
Mr. Fuller, I do have one public comment, which is a recognition that as I look out at our board and the executive staff, there is a common thread. Not only does everyone look excessively handsome, pretty, and dapper, but everyone is proudly wearing purple. And you might say, is that the favorite color of the day? And it is, because we are proudly wearing our purple, and we have our principal at Montgomery High School, Dr. Shear, to celebrate our Bears going to the playoffs this Friday, New Caney, and Dr. Shear, all of us, and I know I speak for the mayor who Ms. Port and I were speaking with on Friday, and the Chamber of Commerce, the entire city and community is rooting for our Bears, even those that might be Lions right now, but at the end of the day, we're all Montgomery ISD. Go Bears.
On to the consent agenda. Does anyone wish to pull any items from the consent agenda for discussion? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed and abstentions. I'm sorry, Miss Graves. Yes, ma'am.
We have a special presentation tonight.
Oh, we do.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
I'm not on that.
We do.
People here that are not in purple.
Not oh,
excuse me, I'm sorry. Sorry, I didn't know the mic was
I
on.
I apologize. I apologize to the community, and I apologize for skipping over that. We do have a special recognition and presentation that I see now on the agenda, and I apologize for that. Ms. Graves, would you please lead us in that?
Yes. About 3 years ago, we encouraged our elementary schools to search for some innovative ideas to implement in their school, to kind of brand their school, and to make each school just a little bit different. We all follow the same curriculum. We all use the same programs. We're very much alike in that way, but we felt like we needed each school to have a little different flair. So Leinster Elementary, under the leadership of Dr. Catherine Bartlett, started looking at Leader in Need. It's a long process. It's an in-depth process. Her staff was more than willing to join her on that journey. It typically is a 5-year process to earn the Leader in Need status, but Dr. Bartlett and Leinster Elementary earned the Leader in Need status, like house status, in 3 years. And so tonight we want to recognize her and the Camp Leinster Elementary for this accomplishment. It's a huge accomplishment, a lot of hard work, and we're really proud of them. So Dr. Bartlett, would you like to share?
I would. Thank you so much. So I want to just share some of our slides. There are 79, so clearly I want to share. However, this was our digital evidence binder we turned in. As part of this process of thinking, the process included, over the course of years, us collecting many different artifacts, videos, pictures, some written examples of how we implement the Leader in Me in our schools. And so last spring, we were set to have this in April, and we had the choice to either do it virtually, where they would interview our boys and girls through Zoom and our parents and our teachers, or just wait till the fall. So, of course, in April, we're like, oh my gosh, fall, October, it'll be totally fine and back to normal. And it wasn't, right? But we did have the opportunity to have them come out and be in our school one full day. And what I want to share is that on that day, they spent about 25 minutes interviewing us as administrators. And the rest of the day, they were with children, they were in classrooms, they were interviewing parents on a parent panel. They talked to all of our staff members. So our part was very minimal, and they had viewed this digital binder. So this is the part that I brought to share with you as well. They looked at the culture of our school, our academic achievement, our student leadership, and then we were able to achieve the lighthouse status. So we're super proud of that. That's why we're not in purple today. We just got these sweatshirts. But and so I just want to share a few things. This first video, and I want to just remind you that we did this in April, so nobody has any masks on in our whole binder. So one thing that we did every grade level each month is honored. We have big pep rallies. We call them Tribe Day. I know a few of you have been out to our pep rallies. This is one that our fourth grade put together last year. It kind of sums up our whole school, I think. Okay.
You know we're talking about the Leader in Me. You know we're talking about the Leader. It encourages us to be our best. Leader in Me, you know they're bringing out the Leader in Me. It teaches leadership and accountability, problem solving, to think creatively, be proactive. I'm in charge all the time, habit two. Begin with the end in mind, habit three. Put your first things first, you must work before you play for. Think win-win, habit five. Seek first to understand, habit six. You've got to synergize, don't forget to sharpen your saw. You know we're talking about the Leader in Me. You know we're talking about the Leader. Adaptability,
So I am going to skip through some of our slides. I was afraid to delete any because it's on our big OneDrive, and I'm afraid I won't ever get them back if that happens. So it's good. Or we'll watch them all. Perfect. Okay, so throughout our process, all of our staff is trained. We have different themes that we look at each month. We have action team with all of our staff involved. So everyone has a job. Everybody is part of the process. A big tenet that we follow is many hands make light work. And so as soon as someone joins our staff, they're able to go to the big training for Leader in Me. It's based on 7 habits of highly effective people. And then they're assigned to an action team. We try to get everybody's input on what they're most interested in. They give us all some different options, and we build those teams so that everyone, as we move forward, is part of the decision-making process. We have direct lessons that the teachers use workbooks for, but they are integrated within our TEKS and our curriculum that we use. We have an action team that puts the direct lesson plan together so that everyone is learning about the same thing. So at dinner that night, they're all learning about, they can talk about Habit 5. They've done different activities with it, and of course it looks different in a kindergarten room than in a fifth grade room, but they can still have that same conversation. Right. You can see on this one, the mission statements. Every student in every classroom has a mission statement that supports the mission statement of our school. They all create their own individual one. One of the best parts of Leinster Elementary is just like that picture in the corner in the bottom left. You will see our big kids helping our little kids all of the time, because that's a huge part of this program is the jobs and the collaboration across the grade level. And that's our favorite part, I think, of being at school with our kids, was seeing that, like on the first day when all of our kids came back, it wasn't a problem at all, because I had all these big kids like, oh, I can tell you where to go, and it didn't matter that moms weren't there to walk them in. They did just fine. In the past, when we've been able to have watchdogs, we would have them come in and talk about Habit 3. It's begin with the end in mind, and so they can look at that and see, okay, I might want to have that job as well, and they can get a little bit of training for that. We train our families up. When they join us, we have a back-to-school night. This year, everything's virtual. We send those out in our weekly newsletters. Our boys and girls teach those habits at the family night. It's not taught by any of the adults. You can look right there and see the parents and families go through a little rotation system. At home, we like to support this as well. We have places on our Facebook where they can share how it's happened at their house, where parents can brag on their kids for sharing a lesson, and so they bring those back to school. We share those on the announcements. These are some examples of some school-wide art projects. It has the one in the middle has a thumbprint from every child in our school. The ones on the left have input from every fifth grader in our school. At the end of the year, they have a big art tribute project that they give to our school. And that was our garden day. That was a big old cabbage. These are some examples of jobs that our boys and girls might have in our school. Every day they start off with a mission statement. So these are fifth grade and third grade sharing their mission statement. We can share this little video of kindergarten mission statement.
Our class mission statement is
So that's just a way they start their morning. They all know those by heart. It's different for every classroom. I do want to shout out to our child nutrition. They are part of the process. They are right there, and they know the 7 habits. They support them in the cafeteria. They are leaders for our school.
Dr. Bartlett, while you were waiting for video to catch up with you, this was an award where you basically had to do all the presentation to the panel, and it was really their meeting with you that sealed the deal, correct?
It was their meeting in our school with all of our boys and girls and our parents that sealed the deal. I don't think they would have recognized me 30 minutes after they walked out of the building because they spent very little time with us. In fact, it was really awkward because I wanted to get on the video cameras and be like, where are they right now? We wanted to look at them on the monitors because they were really there to see, like anyone can put a video together, right? Anybody can do a PowerPoint. But it's where the rubber meets the road is when they come into your school. And I think when you walk into Lone Star, then these are exactly the examples you'll see and the feelings that you'll get being in there. So student leadership roles, our boys and girls apply for an interview and get a job either in their classroom on their grade level or a campus-wide job. So we have a job fair this year. Our action team in charge of that did it virtually. So it was during those first 3 weeks when we were all remote. All of our boys and girls filled out job applications remotely, and so that was really impressive. These are some times their leadership role might have to do with tracking their data for their grade level, so like attendance or academic goals. When we have programs, back in the days of programs, you know, this was a great role. Like, so our kids love to help set up and take down. If that's a job for some of them, and so they like that behind the scenes as well. It's really been powerful for everybody to find their voice, putting up the flag, teachers in training, working with our boys and girls. Find your voice is my favorite thing. That is a question from our student lighthouse team. So today's, I walked by and today's was, have you set a wig for January? Let's hold each other accountable. And so you can drop your goal there if you've set a goal for January as well. They share some of the responses on the announcements so everybody can hear them. And then of course our tribe day when we would have big pep rallies. And, you know, that was so great to get started. Our high school supported us on that because, you know what, elementary kids just don't really know how pep rallies look, right? Like, they haven't probably been to a pep rally, so our first one was an epic failure. And so Lake Creek came over with their drums and their cheerleaders and taught them how to have a pep rally, and it was really awesome. So we are just tracking our school goals, whether it's attendance or academics. Each grade level has that. Our staff track their own personal goals. We model that for the boys and girls, and they track theirs. That's the kindergartner tracking his ABC goals. He's coloring those in. We celebrate those. They monitor them in their leadership notebook. Every boy and girl in our school has a leadership notebook where they save their celebrations, where they track their academic success. So these were some examples of other jobs. Those were like small counselors teaching our pre-K how to calm down, how to take big breaths. That's what planning looks like at Lone Star. That's a year-long plan. And so we can look at that and see where we are. We won't have a really heavy month. We can kind of space it out and see, okay, we have a lot of blue going on in this month. Let's hold off on red and green because everything's color-coded. It involves all of our staff and our boys and girls based on these paradigms. That's our drum line right in the middle, those big pickle buckets, and they are really impressive. This little girl decided a job we needed was to be the mascot. We didn't have that available. That was Miss Lout. And so she stole that job from her because she wrote a big old platform for it and had great information, and she was amazing. So I hope when she, I hope she tries out for mascot at Oak Hills because she was awesome. It's involved all of our teachers and staff, and we just appreciate having the opportunity and having the support from the district in order to do that. Let's see. And then the end part right here is our culture. We do a survey. We send out a measurable result assessment to all of our parents and our fourth and fifth grade students and get that information about culture and academics and leadership opportunities, so that we can align those and put it all together for the success of our school. So thank you for letting us share. It's just been a great opportunity, and we'd love to see you anytime. You can see it in action too. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bartlett. To the board members, I've had a real pleasure getting to see Lone Star in action. If you are having a rotten day, go to Lone Star, and it will put you in the right spirit. So thank you, Dr. Bartlett and Ms. Lout, and all the teachers and parents for what y'all do there for the kiddos. All right, we have approved the consent agenda and are now moving forward to the action items. Actually, if you don't mind, board, I have one more recognition I would like to interject, a point of privilege, if you don't mind. All of us have participated in a variety of training in the past few days, all the board members, and I want the community to know that we're doing that, we're taking it seriously. And so I just wanted to call y'all out and say thank y'all for doing that and taking the time from your schedule. So now we'll move on to the action items. I'll get my act here sooner or later together. And our first action item is the consideration of approval for the 2021-2022 course selection guides for junior high and high school. Mr. McFadden.
Good evening. This is a process that takes place really early in a year for next year, where we're planning for the 21-22 school year, but it starts in October. And so this process that we're going to use, that we use, is a process that's followed at both the high school campuses and the junior high campuses. We produce a course selection guide for both junior high. Both junior highs have one guide, and both high schools use the same course selection guide, and that keeps us consistent between the two different tracks, or the two different schools. The process begins in early October. Course selection materials are distributed to the campus departments for input on possible changes. It can be anything in a legislative year. Sometimes it's legislative changes that we need to make to graduation plans or whatever. In non-legislative years, like this year, we do things like propose new courses. Teachers can advocate for new courses to finish out their pathways. We can expand our career pathways. We look at advanced weighting of courses. If teachers want to advocate for an advanced weighting on an engineering course or a course that they're teaching, they can advocate for that to get kids to take those harder, more intensive classes. And then if any of the course descriptions need to be updated, we look at those as well. In late October, we begin having meetings with both the junior high and the high school campuses, those course selection committees, and we discuss and update the course selection guides. This year at the high school, one of the things we did differently was we asked Region 6 to come down, a consultant from Region 6, Tally Stout, who is in CTE, and we asked her to go through all of our pathways, our career pathways, and make sure that they're updated and in line with current state requirements, but also some new stuff coming down in CTE. And so she helped us with that process, and we were able to align a lot of them to align them so that they're more streamlined and make sure that each course in the pathway was getting CTE credit or pathway credit. And then we were also able to add two new pathways. One was a practicum in manufacturing to flesh out our robotics pathway, and then the other was medical therapy in our athletic training program. Kids prior to this time were able to take athletic training, but it wasn't considered a pathway, and we weren't getting any CTE funding for it. Dr. Scher was instrumental. That was one of the first areas she looked at, and she said, we can be getting, those kids that are going to stay in this for 4 years, we can be getting a pathway for that, and we can also be getting CTE funding for the last 2 years. And so it was an easy move to make, and so we added a medical therapy. So the last two classes that these kids would take would be physical therapy 1 and 2, which align very, very closely to the athletic training process. In November, meetings were held with both the superintendent student leadership committees, and this was a Dr. Morrison thing. We had never done this before, but it was a good thing to do. We met with the outgoing seniors to say, what are some things that maybe, it can't help you because you're going to be graduating under your plan, but what would be some things that we could think about for the students that are coming up through the system? And so they provided input on course expansion, some dual credit AP offerings and some weighting that they felt like they would want. But the one of the things we were able to implement that did affect them was on dual credit classes that are online only. They asked, why do we have to come and have a period of the day where it's online? And we thought at one point it was because of attendance, but that rule has gone by the wayside. And so if they have late arrival or early dismissal built in their schedule, they can, of course, have that dual credit class during that time. So we were able to readjust the schedules in order to put their dual credit classes in the beginning and end of the day. And so those students no longer, they can either take an additional class or they can have a late arrival or an early dismissal if they have the credits to do that. And most of those students do. After the changes are submitted and discussed by the course selection committee, then the guides are updated. You have a copy of both guides in your board materials. You also have a synopsis of what the changes are at both the junior high and the high school. The main thing that for this year is that we added new courses in the guide, and so we listed out what the courses. There are several new AP courses that we want to offer if they make, and then there were several CTE courses that we added in order to flesh out some of the CTE pathways. And one of those were at the junior high. We did add another Gateway class. Gateway is the junior high program for Project Lead the Way, which is a big engineering program and computer science program in the high schools. And so we were able to add Gateway to Flight and Space. And we are able to get CTE credit now at the junior high level, so it's important for us to add those courses when we can. So that's a brief overview of the process and the changes in the guides. If you have any questions, I'll try to answer them. If not, we'd ask for you to approve them so we can get started with student registration in January and February.
Board members, any questions? Is there a motion?
Make a motion to approve the 2021-2022 MISD junior high and high school course selection guides as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Motion passes. Thank you. All right. Next, we are moving on for our next action item to the consideration of approval for a resolution to continue leave related to the Families First Coronavirus Response Act beyond December 31st. Mr. Chris Lynn, take it away.
I'm going to, very quickly, there's going to be a series of either action items or information items tonight that really speak to, we can never be fully focused enough on the safety and the psychological safety of our employees. This has been an unprecedented year in every way imaginable, and anything that we can do to give our employees peace of mind, to put one less thing off of their plate that they have to worry about, if it's available for us to do it, then we're going to give it every consideration, and when needed, bring it to this board for action and consent. And so this is something that was an introduction to the way we did business at the beginning of the year. It was a, you have to do it. Now it's up to us to decide to do it on behalf of our employees. So I'll turn it over to Chris Lynn.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Morrison. So this evening we are asking you to approve a resolution that would extend leave related to the, and we like to use acronyms in everything that we do in education. And so we refer to it as the FFCRA, which is the Families First Coronavirus Response Act. And that a portion of that act allows employees to access 10 days of paid sick leave when they're unable to work due to either being COVID positive, showing symptoms of COVID, or having to be quarantined because they came into close contact with somebody who was COVID positive. And so we're asking for your approval this evening because this federal act expires December 31st of 2020. And at this point, there has been no discussion to extend this act. While we cannot extend a federal law, you can adopt a resolution and allow us to continue with the guidelines that were in place under the federal law. And so that's what we're asking for tonight. This is, just to be clear, this is not an additional 10 days of paid leave. So anybody who has already used their 10 days before December 31st would not get an additional 10 days. This is just a carryover for the second semester for those individuals who have not had the opportunity to use those 10 days. And under the resolution, this action would be effective until June 30th, 2021, or until the federal government takes action to continue this federal law. And so, as Dr. Morrison said, we believe this is the right thing to do for our employees moving forward in the second semester, and we would ask for your approval of this resolution tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Lynn. Board members, are there any questions?
Just real quick, just to point out, you had said really the only financial cost, and I support it, don't get me wrong, but the only financial cost is that of a substitute that would be offset for the 10 days, right?
Yes, sir. And as Dr. Morrison said earlier, we were required to do this in the first semester. However, we were not provided the funding to pay for this anyway. So we've already been paying for it, and that's why we feel like it's the right thing to do for our employees moving forward in the second semester.
Other questions?
This expires when the school year is over, correct?
Yes, sir.
Anyone else? Sensing no more questions, is there a motion?
I'll move to approve the resolution to continue leave related to families' first coronavirus response act beyond December 31, 2020, as presented.
Thank you, Ms. Porton. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? It carries. Thank you, Mr. Lynn.
Thank you.
Dr. Morrison. All right, now we're moving on to information items, and I have on our first topic under information items, school security updates, Mr. Bobby Morris and Chief Phillips later.
Yes, sir. Thank you. It's an honor to be able to present just a brief school update on school security this evening, and as was discussed in closed session, you received an updated report on the school safety audit, and glad to get that done. On September 1st of 2005, the Texas legislators enacted a law, Senate Bill 11, that requires school districts in the state of Texas to have a school safety audit at least once every 3 years. Also in that act, it required all school districts to develop an emergency crisis plan that addressed all hazards approach to emergency planning, along with planning addressing the four phases of emergency management: mitigation, preparation, response, and recovery. I'm proud to say that Montgomery ISD has completed their audit, as stated earlier, we have complied with the state law by sending that audit to the school safety center in Texas, and we did that in early November. Also, this year, for the first time, the state is requiring school districts across the state to submit their emergency plans to the state. And what I was told about this from Region 6 is the reason that the state is now requiring districts to submit their emergency plan is for, not for an I gotcha thing, but for them to be able to check plans to make sure they have the four phases in them. And if they don't, what kind of training do they need to offer school districts across the state of Texas to get their emergency plans in the shape that they need to be in? Also, the Texas Education Code in Chapter 37.109 requires school districts to establish a school safety and security committee. This committee is required to meet at a minimum three times a year, once in the fall, once in the spring, and once in the summer. MISD has established the Safety and Security Committee, which at this present time has over 20 members participating on that committee. The committee consists of city management personnel, local city police personnel, district employees, including teachers, school board members, including three of y'all, and parents of students within our district. Again, our district has complied, has been in compliance with this law for several years, and our committee held its first fall meeting on December the 10th, last Thursday, 2020. So of the three requirements that the state requires school districts to comply with concerning safety and security, our school district is in compliance with the law. And I'm going to turn it over to Chief Stephen Phillips. It's an honor for me to be able to invite Chief Phillips to the podium. We brought the right man to the school district to run our police department. This school district put many hours of work into making sure that we got the right guy. And our lady just ended up being a guy. And Chief Phillips brings to our district 26 years of law enforcement experience. 21 of those years are in the school business. He spent 10 years in Spring ISD and the previous 11 years with Lone Star Community College. Not one negative word did we hear about Chief Phillips. It was outstanding references, everything outstanding about him. Dr. Morrison and I went and knocked on doors of his neighbors. And Dr. Morrison was talking to a gentleman at the door, and I was kind of standing behind him. And I'm assuming it was his wife, the guy that his neighbor that Dr. Morrison was talking to. She runs up from behind and jumps up where we can see her face, and she says, "We love him." And she turns around and leaves. And that's the kind of man we got, the kind of man that people love, the kind of man people are going to respect, and the kind of man that's going to do a great job for Montgomery ISD leading our police department. It's an honor for me to ask Chief Stephen Phillips to report to the podium. Thank you.
Chief, I have one favor to ask before we do that. Bobby, if you'll come back for just a second. I think a lot of the same things could be said about you, Mr. Morris. You've announced your resignation, or your retirement, excuse me. And I just want to recognize that. I could sense the emotion, and I want to say a sincere thank you on behalf of this board for 22 years of service to the district, and to let you know that I personally believe the district is in a much better place because of you, Mr. Morris. So as a matter of record, I'd like to say thank you, and just tell you I'm excited for your retirement, Bobby.
Thank you.
All right, Chief, now that I'm emotional, take it away.
Let me thank Bobby for that grand introduction. Man, I thought he was talking about somebody else. So I'm just going to give an overview of my first 30 days. I want to thank the board and thank Dr. Morrison for all that he has done while I've been here for the first 30 days. And so starting off, we talked about a lot of things, and we wanted to develop relationships with the community, with different agencies that are within the department. And we started off by communicating with these various agencies and talking with department heads, and we don't want to just stop at this particular point at these agencies, but we want to continue on and talk to other leaders within the community, and to make sure that we have a good partnership and relationship with all of those agencies as well. We talked about, we went ahead and we had an inventory of our police department items, such as our vehicles, our property, our armory, evidence inventory, uniform inventory, and our Blue Santa funds inventory, and all of our inventory came up positive. And we are in the place of putting together some good practices for the department so that we show transparency and good stewardship of the things that are in our possession. We also reached out to the community and had very good dialogue and communication with all of our partners within the district, some partners outside of the district as well, to develop that relationship and that professionalism that we want to bring to the district with our police department. So see, these are some of the things that we had an opportunity to participate in, parades. We had an opportunity to participate with the elementary school. We did a video for a career day. So we want to be very involved within the district and the community as well. For our officers, we talk about training because we think that training is very important to have a well-rounded officer. And so we have been in contact with the city, the county, constables, the sheriff's department, and other agencies that will be able to provide training for our officers to make sure that they are well-trained and up to the task that we have employed them to do. So we are in the process now of teaming up with Montgomery Police Department to do some training with active shooter, with the sheriff department to do walkthroughs for active shooter, and with the constable's office, precinct one, to do additional training as well. Some of the accomplishments that we have achieved in the last 30 days, we have been able to purchase our radio encryption agreements. We've done many, a couple of MOUs with Montgomery County Dispatch and also Children's Safe Harbor. We have established a good protocol for our NIBRS reporting system, which we will start reporting in the springtime, random drug testing for our officers, and also the biggest thing, the new police department, which will be established here in the ESC. So for the future of this department, we want to be a viable source of information within the community, within the district, and that's only going to become more positive as the people we employ, the officers that are on the force right now, being better prepared with our vehicles and our communications, which goes around the district and around the city and the county. We want to develop good traffic flow for our district and the schools that we enforce and do traffic control enforcement on. Any questions?
What I'd like to say is, you know, we've talked numerous times already, and he's been very open to suggestions. He's asked me for advice, and like I said, he's gathering all kinds of information from everybody in the field, and so far what I've seen, it's been great. And I think it's just like building from the bottom up, and I think he's going up.
Thank you, sir.
I'll bet you on that.
Thank you. Other questions?
I just wanted to add that I'm excited to see what you're going to do and excited to see what you've already done in the first 30 days. Very excited about the relationships you've been building with the area other officers and departments, and I think that can only help us, and that's fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you. We got a long way to go.
Mr. Flore, I always want to make sure that we're bringing accuracy to anything we share at a board meeting. I do appreciate Mr. Morris saying that there was a thorough review of Chief. That is absolutely true. There was record reviews, there was employment visitations, there was a home visit. That encounter with his neighbors actually was exactly the way it occurred. I would say it would be accurate to say overwhelmingly we heard nothing but positives, dignity, respect, honor, service. Were all things that we heard numerous times from a variety of different individuals that have worked with Stephen Phillips over his tenure in law enforcement. But I think, Mr. Morris, you said there was no negatives, and there was one negative that we did encounter. We did see a video where the chief was dancing. I think that's an area of improvement. Not my opinion only. His wife confirmed that to me as well. So, again, I just don't want to ever give anything but the best information we can to the public. So, would you agree with that, Chief?
It was an off day.
Okay.
It was an off
day. But it was over a course of many days, so I... But other than that, we're good.
All right, board members, any questions? Chief, thank you, and keep us going.
Thank you, Chief.
All right, next we're going to have an information item on Montgomery moving forward, our second semester.
Thank you, Mr. Fuller. As I said earlier in the board meeting, this has been an unprecedented year. It has been a year of challenge. It's been a year of having to really rethink every aspect of what we call pre-K through 12 education. The thing that is humbling is that there are no other school districts that have the answer, because every school district across Texas and across the United States, across the world, is having to do the same thing we are doing, which is how do we best educate our children, how do we keep our students and staff safe, and how do we try to create the best conditions for education on our pathway for continuing to make Montgomery ISD the premier school district in the state of Texas. As I've often said, we do not get to choose the challenges we face. We do get to choose how we face them. And every time we've had the opportunity to listen to our employees, engage our employees, listen to our parents, our students, we've taken advantage of that to continue to try to get better and better. And I think our mantra earlier in the year that we shared with the board was everything is subject to change. And so as we look forward to the second semester, we have continued to think about how to change, to continue to grow, to iterate, and to do things that will give our students the best opportunity for academic rigor and excellence, and to keep our schools open, to keep our programs accessible, and to really make sure that we are not always going to be perfect, but that we do strive for excellence. So we're going to share with the board tonight some things that are different around those students in our school district and families that are choosing to continue with remote instruction. We put some additional processes into place that we think are appropriate and needed. We're also share with you some opportunities that have been afforded to us by the state of Texas and TEA in terms of additional ways to keep students and staff safe and to return them as quickly as we can back to school if they have been exposed to COVID. Then also some things that we continue to do to keep our employees top of mind, to give them one of the things that during this year they are all struggling with, which is time. And so we'll share some of those plans as well. With that, I'd like to ask Wendy Graves and Dwayne McFadden to come forward with our process for choosing remote instruction.
All right, as we look ahead to the second semester and try to plan for a successful semester, we have determined that it would be best that we ask our parents to complete an application of intent for remote instruction for the second semester. During the first semester, we changed at grading period. So at the grading period, if you decided that you wanted to go back to remote, you could. That presented a lot of challenges for our staff in keeping the program organized and efficient. So we determined that for the second semester, we would ask our parents to please apply for an application of intent. That application went out October 30th through November 13th. We had 157 elementary applicants, which was 111 less remote students than we had in the fall semester. So our parents are choosing to send them back. I think they've recognized that we have a lot of good procedures in place, and our number one priority is to keep all of our children safe. So I think our parents are feeling more comfortable with what we're doing, and they're sending them back. At the secondary level, we had 350 applicants, and that's 291 less than we had in the fall. For the approval process, we simply looked at how did they do in the fall. How were their grades and their attendance? If they were failing or if they had really poor attendance, we did deny their remote application. We denied 16 at the elementary level and 56 at the secondary level. The parent does have the opportunity to schedule a meeting with the teacher and the principal to talk about that appeal or that denial and ask for additional consideration to continue remote. At that time, when they ask for that consideration, we are going to ask that they provide us with medical documentation before we approve remote instruction for the spring. We feel like asking for a commitment for the semester is going to make us more efficient and make the remote instruction even better than it was in the fall. So.
Before we move on to the next thing, does anyone have the 291 in that did not get applications turned in? We only asked them to apply if they were intending to stay remote or go remote. I do not believe that out of the 291 that didn't fill out an application, that means that 291 are going to suddenly come back to school. I think we sent them a letter saying, welcome back. We're expecting you back on January 5th because you didn't fill out an application. But I've already started to the letters went out last week. I'm already starting to get contacted on and medical documentation coming in. So we think once this process is through, we'll be 92% or better back in school, in-person instruction. And it's the or better is going to depend on the 291 that didn't fill out applications. If more of those kids come back, then that number is going to go up. But I think the worst case scenario is that we have 92% of our kids in person and 8% that will be remote at this time, which is a pretty good number from what some surrounding districts are having and what we expected. So I think it's going to be a good thing. I'm going to talk about something that we did that initially we did it for our teachers because in the secondary, because there's two pathways that of how we teach in the schools. K through five, your self-contained classrooms for the most part, second grade is second grade, third grade is third grade, and so on. Every kid has a third grade curriculum. Every kid has a second grade curriculum. When you get to junior high and high school, there's a lot more deviations to their schedule, a lot more leveling of classrooms, and so it's much harder to have a completely remote environment. So our teachers are currently doing a hybrid model of instruction, and so it takes a lot of time. They may have 17 kids in front of them and 5 kids that are remote for that period. And that's for ultimate flexibility in a kid that has to quarantine. One day last week, we quarantined 56 kids, so those kids have to flip over to remote instruction for that 7 to 10 days. That hybrid model allows that to occur without a disruption to their schedule. We couldn't possibly reschedule all those kids for 7 days into a remote experience and then back in 10 days later or 7 days later. And so the hybrid model was what worked for us. But the thing we kept hearing from our teachers was we need time. We need time to work with our remote kids. And so we implemented a pilot program called the Late Arrival. And we had five late arrival Wednesdays. When I say late arrival, I'm not talking about teachers. Teachers are still working 8.5 hours a day. This is late arrival for students only. And so we ran this pilot program. And I've got to be honest with you, this is the most successful thing that I've ever implemented that's been almost 100% positive from both faculty, staff, students, and parents. I've gotten emails from parents that have said, we love late arrival Wednesdays. My kids get extra hours of sleep, or I've gotten to have breakfast with our kid, or we take them to school on that day. But it's been more than one. I mean, it's been a handful of emails, which normally emails are not sent in that level that are positive in nature. And so every time we go to campus, we either have a kid or a teacher say, are we going to continue? Are we going to continue? And so we have worked out a way for us to have 8 additional late arrival Wednesdays in the spring. We have minutes built into our schedule that allow us to do that. And so that roughly equates to every other Wednesday or really 2 a month, because we can't have them every other, or you'd hit an A day every time. And we wanted to make sure we hit an A day and then a B day. Teachers are using that extra 2.5 hours in the morning to communicate with their remote instruction kids, to plan with the other teachers to load lessons into their Google Classroom that they didn't have time for before, because we switched to a block schedule on the fly, which means teachers have four classes all day one day and three classes another day, and only have one conference every other day. So they're teaching 8 hours straight, the equivalent of 8 hours straight every other day. So they needed additional time. It's worked out well, and so we're happy that we're going to be able to communicate that we're going to do three. They're on the calendar already, and we will communicate these through both the district and the campuses. We think we're going to send out on Tuesday night. We'll just send out a school messenger that says tomorrow's a late arrival or tomorrow's a regular Wednesday, so that people aren't confused by it, but they can also put it on their calendars. The students won't forget, the parents might. In thinking about that, we thought our elementary teachers are, even though most of them are back to pre-COVID teaching in their classroom, it's still, they can benefit from additional time, and so we're going to provide two early release days for the elementary grades on March 10th and April 28th. And teachers will be at work. It's not an early release for teachers, it's just an early release for students to allow additional planning time for the teachers at that level. And we do have instructional minutes in our calendar that allow for both of these and for the 8 late arrivals. So that's our expansion, and it's been overwhelmingly positive that people are enjoying that, and they're finding it's almost, you know, a lot of our high school kids will get on a hamster wheel, and they're like, they're in band and athletics and choir and honor society, and they're just going all the time. And research shows that those teenage kids need more sleep anyway, and so it's really been nice for them. We, in our senior leadership groups, they really spoke highly of, it's just nice to have one day where I don't have to be somewhere, or I can sleep in, or I can have a leisurely pace in the morning. And so we were happy to be able to do that.
Just a couple of additional comments to what Mr. McFadden shared. For both the elementary and the secondary, this is time for the teachers. It's time for planning. It's time for reaching out to parents. It's time to do the remote instruction and loading those lessons at the secondary level. It is not a time for additional district expectations. That is protected time for our teachers and much needed. If you are asked, as I'm sure we will be, people will be very happy to hear about the additional days, both at the secondary level and at the elementary. With the secondary, if you are asked the question, why not discontinue with the every Wednesday if it was so successful? We are bound by instructional minutes, and we simply did not have enough instructional minutes built into this current year's calendar to be able to extend that in the second semester every Wednesday. So we were able to, for lack of a better way, do it every other Wednesday, thinking about the not wanting to miss the same classes, or there were some testing things with AP testing that we had to consider. But again, I think both at the elementary and secondary level, this would be exceptionally well received by our educators. The other thing I'll say is, I believe that to be true, because as we've been doing calendars, and we'll be bringing you calendar recommendations to the board in January, this concept of additional time for PLCs, professional learning committees, whether it's through late arrival or early dismissal, was a strong advocacy from our employees to be built into next year's calendar. So I think, it's just another indication of the success of this initiative. And I'd like to say the credit belongs to the my team, and the credit for the execution of it certainly belongs to the team. But it was really myself and Mr. McFadden, myself, and Ms. Graves going out and talking to teachers, teacher leaders, and administrators where this idea of late arrival first really kind of came up. And I will always say that innovation starting off at our campuses is really where it belongs.
I do have one question. Why, you know my opinion on this already, but why didn't we do it across the board for our campuses?
Well, and I think the big answer to that is, for all but six of our elementary teachers at this time, they're teaching pre-COVID. They're teaching like they were before virtual and remote instruction. And the other side of that is, we were really aware of the impact it might have on childcare in the mornings for elementary kids without having the other kids. You know, junior high kids can go out and catch the bus by themselves where elementary can't. And I may have stepped on.
No, that's exactly right. You know, currently we have 14 teachers in the elementary, at the elementary level, that are involved with remote, 14 FTEs. Some may be doing half day, some may be doing full day, but a total of 14 FTEs. So we're you can't say we're back to normal, obviously, but we have the schedule that we had pre-COVID. There are a few COVID things that we have to do, like we have to do some cleaning of our manipulatives that we use, that sort of thing, but we're not asking our elementary teachers to actually function in two roles like we're asking our secondary teachers. We do recognize that our elementary teachers need some time to plan, and so that's why we have recommended that they have some time in the second semester.
And Mr. Dennis, I appreciate the question, and trust me, we've had this conversation with our elementary principals. I have communication councils, one elementary, one secondary, where we've spoken about this quite a bit. And I've gone out directly and spoken to our elementary campuses. And quite frankly, I was inviting, okay, I'm sure you've heard what's happening at the secondary. How upset are you? And the vast majority of our elementary teachers completely understand. While you will never hear me or I think any of my staff ever say teachers have enough time, they don't. And we have to be aware of that. They have so many responsibilities on them, and time is never their friend. But as we were looking at the differences of this year to last year, for our secondary teachers, they teach their in-person classes, but then they have the additional burden, every secondary teacher, of having to do the remote instruction as well. And they were really struggling for, where is there going to be a negative impact? Is it going to be for my in-person students, or is it going to be my ability to get timely information to my remote instructors, my ability to reach out to parents? That dual pressure of a hybrid instructional model was just causing tremendous duress. The way we were able to avoid that was working with our six elementary campuses. Great work by our administrators, great work by our teachers to be able to not have our teachers be burdened having to do both remote and in person. And through the first semester, we've had about 14 teachers doing remote. Everyone else is doing in person. As we go back into the second semester, where we're getting down to six or seven, we will have, again, six or seven teachers doing remote. Every other teacher will be doing in person. That being said, there are some challenges of this year. There are additional pressures. We really challenged ourselves, could we do something for our elementary educators as well? And I will say the vast majority of them were not asking for it. So I think, again, this will be well received. But the ability to give them some additional time through an early dismissal, especially around grading time, was something that we think will be well received. As we thought about, should we do more? The challenge, and we want to be very cognizant of this, is that when we do the late arrival for our secondary, it has a limited amount of parents who are impacted by having to provide any sort of support or daycare for their students. When we do it at elementary, it causes tremendous challenges to our community, tremendous challenges to our parents, and we want to be cognizant of that. We want to be respectful of that. So again, this is something we will continue to look at. We will continue to push ourselves, but that was the thinking and the outreach that went into this decision.
And I was really impressed with the elementary teachers who said, no, they need the time. They're being asked to do a lot. So they were very gracious and very understanding with our decision that was made for the early release. So they were very supportive of the secondary teachers for the most part. Yeah.
Has there been any negative comments about continuing the program?
The late arrival
on Wednesday. Yeah.
We have not. Several of our campuses sent out surveys. We've done a lot of outreach through our town halls, through community meetings, town halls, my communication councils with teachers, my leadership meetings with students. Mr. McFadden was not exaggerating. He is often to do that. But when we go into a secondary campus, it does not, we take about five steps before someone's coming out and saying, hey, those late arrivals. We really love them. Are you going to do them for second semester? So we've said stay tuned for the board meeting. For all of the things we're updating you with tonight, as soon as we finish the board meeting, we will be sending out a communication to our employees to let them know about the late arrivals, the early dismissals at the elementary campus, and some of the other things that we're doing tonight. We cannot over-communicate.
So an extension of that question, and I do recognize what Mr. McFadden said earlier, the vast majority of people that have either emailed me or spoken to the board as a whole via email have been positive. There have been a few that have said, you know, hey, what do you want me to do with my kiddo, you know, now that on this one day that we need to go to late arrival. So one of the things I liked about the pilot was the option that if you had gotten to a situation, we would try to work it out. Is that still going to be on the plate,
Absolutely.
Mr. McFadden?
Yes.
Okay.
If there's no way for them to not, they're still taking them at 7 a.m. just like they would on any regular day, and they're okay. just providing an opportunity for them to be in a computer lab or a library, and it's not, there's no, you know, we're just trying to provide a place for them where they're supervised if need be.
Okay. Thank you.
Is that being provided now or not?
It is.
It is? But it's just not really public out there, or it is public?
No, it's not used very often. Usually a kid, we had a few in the beginning, and they're just like, wow, I really don't want to sit here for 3 hours and, you know, work on my, I'd rather. And so a lot of them have found rides with neighbors if it was a ride issue. High school kids, you know, they're going to find a ride with a upperclassman or someone.
And then we also have a communication set. We'll probably go out tomorrow to families, communities to update them on some of the things that happened at the board meeting tonight. And in there is specific information with the dates for the late arrivals, early dismissals. And there is actually a line in there around if there is any challenge to your ability to be able to get your child to school, let us know. And we'll work with them in terms of providing that opportunity. We don't want this to be a negative consequence on a family, and we recognize that anytime we change schedules, it does create a burden.
Sure, and we're, and our teacher, the full staffs are at the school, so it's not, you know, we're able to accommodate as many as we need to accommodate. It just hasn't been an issue.
Mr. Dennison, did you have a comment?
So this is, I guess, this isn't open for a vote, it's more like an executive decision, correct?
The board votes on a calendar, which you will do in January. We do have, through board policy, ability to change certain aspects of student and staff work time and instructional time. We have to follow the TEA guidelines for instructional minutes, which is partly why we can't do the every other Wednesday.
On the calendars y'all put out, how many did y'all offer? I can't remember.
On the
that we're going to vote on in January?
I think it's
5.
10.
Do we have the results yet, or it's already voted on?
They're coming in. Yeah, I mean, the voting is taking place right now, I believe.
So just point a.
They'll go to a community vote after that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The calendar process is still underway.
Yeah, there is still community input being sought on the calendars. It starts off with the district advisory committee, which has representation, students, parents, educators from each campus. They work and they solicit campus input. They come forward with a series of different ideas around different ways we could look at the calendar. There are requirements as established by Texas law, policy, and statute. But folks get very creative about how to spread out those teacher days, employee days, and work days and the instructional days for the students. We are at the time now where we've been narrowing those options. They will get down to several options that we will continue to get community input. And then we will bring you the results of that community survey, as well as the option for the calendar for the 2021-2022 academic year. And we'll be presenting all that to you in January.
Other questions? All right.
I think there was one last aspect.
All right, thanks.
Dr. Busby.
Yes, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about rapid testing. So TEA has provided districts the option to participate in this rapid testing program, and we do qualify to participate in it because we offer in-person instruction to all of our students. And so they will send us these testing kits, and then we can provide testing opportunities for our staff and our students at no cost. So we are looking at providing that option of taking that test if they're experiencing symptoms of COVID-19 or if they have had close contact with someone who has been positive. This test is not mandatory. We would never require anyone to have to take this test. It is just one of those things that's a courtesy and a service that we can provide to our staff and our students and our families. So the purpose of the testing is just to identify those positive cases as soon as possible without a financial burden on anyone, and also to reduce the period of time that individuals required to quarantine. If we can reduce that time period, then we can get them back to in-person instruction as quickly as possible, which is our goal, to get them back in the classroom. This testing option is estimated to be available starting mid-January. We're working out on the details of it right now. We've had principal feedback, we've had nurses feedback, we had a small team that kind of put together a plan. Our leadership team has poked holes in that plan, and now we've sent it back out for the principals for another look through, just to kind of see what the process is. And then we'll get those details out when those are finalized, so people will know how to sign up for one of the tests. We do plan on the student testing being at this location so that it's not an additional burden on our campuses or our nurses. And we'll have a little separate entrance where they can come in by appointment and make those and take those tests.
So a couple of things. The reason why we say subject to change is because things keep changing. And about 2 weeks ago, the TEA changed their issuance and guidance. So that we would not have to quarantine individuals for 14 days. It was reduced to 10. And then actually from 10 to 7, if an individual was able to get a positive test, and I think you're gonna present this information, so why don't you take it from there, and then I'll come back to the previous slide.
Yes, sir. So CDC updated their guidelines, and then TEA, looking at that guidance, went back and updated the TEA guidelines, which is what we have followed in all of our protocols. So we reviewed that as a team, and this is a big change. So 14 days is still the golden time period where you need to be watching yourself and monitoring yourself and making sure that you don't show symptoms or anything within that 14 days, and just be cautious within that 14 days. But they have said that that last 10 to 14 days is a much lower risk. So they're saying now, if you have not started developing any symptoms at the end of the 10-day window, you can go ahead and return back to work, return back to school. If you, however, go after day five of from your last day of exposure, go and get a test, and that test is negative, then they say, okay, you can go ahead and return then on day seven. So we have the opportunity to get our employees and our students back a lot sooner under the new guidelines.
And that's really what drove our thinking on this, which is, the first of all, the change in the regulations. We were excited that we wouldn't have to quarantine staff and students for 14 days, but we could get them back in 10. And then the idea of, if they're able to get a test and it's negative after 5 days, we can get them back in 7. So for both students and for staff, the ability to get back on campus, to get back to a routine and a norm, is something that we think is really, really important. In speaking with our administrators and speaking with my communication councils and speaking with the nurses, and the nurses' input was really, really important. We wanted to make sure that we were not overburdening our nurses, and so they will probably be the ones who will take the most focus around any sort of staff testing. We really wanted to make sure that we were not having our schools burdened by this, and so that's why the student aspect of this will be in this building. And it might help a little bit, Dr. Busby, if you see, because when you say testing, it makes it seem like we're actually administering the testing. It's really handing them something. They do the testing themselves, and we are really recording the results. But you we're both doctors, but you're much more doctor like that than I am.
I have been trained as a test administrator already because I wanted to see what that test was all about. So it really is a simple process. It's one of the nasal swabs, but it is not one of them that touches your brain. It is just a lower nasal swab where they can swirl a few times. You put it in the little kit, you fold it, and you wait 15 minutes. And after 15 minutes, you'll be able to tell from the test based on if it's one line, you're negative. If it's two lines, you're positive. So they do register when they come in. We register through the program. So they will also get a text and an email with the results as well.
And really, it's the opportunity to save our students, families, and our staff additional time. Depending on where you try to go get testing, that can be hours. And then oftentimes it's hours being surrounded by other folks who are there potentially being exposed to COVID. And so if you didn't have it before the testing, chances are perhaps you get it after. But really also the cost. And depending on your health service provider, depending on where you get the test can be somewhere around $50, in some cases over $125. And so the ability to save time, the ability to save money for families and our staff just felt a service that if we could provide it, we should provide it. And again, our focus though was especially with the students. We did not want to put that burden on our schools, so that testing will be done here at the Central Services Office.
Is it open to general public?
No. One of the things that we had to agree to when you sign up for the program is that this is something that TEA is providing only for employees and students of the district.
Good. Thank you. Other questions?
Is there any data on the accuracy of the tests that we're getting, the type of tests that we're getting?
Yes, sir. So there is some information that they have provided on the website, and they said that this test has been between, I think, 95 and 97% accurate. So they feel pretty confident in the test that they're giving us.
Is there a lifespan on the test? Did it come in all at once and we run them out for a while, or is it constantly evolving?
A great question. So they allot us a certain amount per month, and so they send us that inventory. And then we actually keep track of the inventory in a system that TEA accesses, and they will not send us any additional tests until we are at a 25% capacity of that. That way we don't ever have anything just sitting on our shelves not getting used.
Is there an expiration date on them? Or?
There was. I cannot remember what it was, but with the plan of the way they were dispersing them, that we should be in good shape.
One other thing too, and Dr. Busby mentioned it in her first slide, not only will there be no instance of requiring this of students and staff, we're not recommending it. We're offering it as a service. If a staff member or a parent wants to take advantage of it, it's there, but it is not mandatory, and nor will it be even suggested that you should do it. That is a choice of a parent, that is a choice of an employee, and totally theirs. We will stay out of that portion of it.
Well, thank you for saying that, Dr. Morrison. That's a question I get a lot on this topic, mostly because a certain educational institution in the region has recently required that of some of its people, and they're not having fun right now. So I appreciate you being very bold and clear on that. So, are there other questions?
Is there anything about disposing the test after they've been used?
Yes, yeah, so just like when you're in a doctor's office and they have the hazardous material waste, the test goes into a hazardous material container.
And who's taking the cost on that? Is that part of the deal also? Or?
Right, our clinics are already supplied with that, so that's kind of our ongoing process. The cost, any costs associated with what we are doing at the district office, we are allowed to use either Title IV monies for that, or also the ESSER grant funds. So we have some pots of money that we can tap into.
Well, Mr. Dennison, his question spurred me to think, Dr. Busby, are there any liabilities, risks for our staff in terms of, you know, hosting this on site? Have we thought through all that, and what parameters have we put in place?
Right, so there are things that TEA has sent us to help with that. They've sent additional PPE, gowns, gloves, masks, all of that. And so, and then the training video that you watch also, they are very, very strict about the way you administer the test, you know, that because they can self-administer it, you should be staying at a distance from the person who's coming in and keeping all of those standards in mind. So depending on if they actually have to assist them, there's additional PPE that they sent, the N95 masks, the full gowns. So they really have supplied us with a lot of materials to help keep whoever the test administrator is safe.
Thank you. Other questions? Dr. Busby, thank you.
Yes, sir.
All right. Our next information item is Mr. McFadden coming up here. For...
There was a little piece of accountability information that came out last week from TEA. And TEA announced that it's going to pause the A through F campus and district accountability ratings for 2021 school year due to disruptions associated with the pandemic. So we will not be rated this year under A through F. What that means, though, is that we're still scheduled to give the STAR exam for in the spring, just like we would in under any other year. Honestly, we think that's a good thing. I really think we need the data from our kids to find out exactly how far the slide is, how we're doing this year, and so on. It's been a real struggle in the fall because we're so used to having data from the spring that drives instruction for the fall that we're struggling with not having that STAR data from the spring because it was canceled totally when the pandemic began last school year. And so, I'm a fan. I think it's a good thing that we're going to continue to give the test. They will have to be on site from everything I'm reading. It will not be in every kid will be have to be given the opportunity to have the test. They're not going to be required, but they're going to be given the opportunity to take the test, and we would encourage parents to allow their child to do that. All public schools and districts will receive a not rated designation for the 2021 school year. So we'll receive one for this year, not rated, and we're going to receive that again next year. We're hoping we get some data because that's how we drive a lot of our instruction. It lets us know where our kids are. We have given assessments this year. We've given the beginning of the year assessment that TEA gave out, and we also have done one benchmark in the fall, and we're going to do another benchmark in the spring. So we are analyzing data, trying to figure out where our kids are and if what we're doing with them is improving, and we're seeing some good results. We talked about that at the junior high, Montgomery Junior High today, and at Montgomery High School today, and we're seeing some good results with that. So we are, instruction hasn't stopped and accountability hasn't stopped just because we're not sure what's happening with the accountability system. The last piece I think is really good news that we wanted to bring to you. It's about graduation for this year. We're proud to announce that the dates for both high school graduations has been established. Lake Creek graduation will be held on Monday, May 24th at 7 p.m. and Montgomery High School graduation will be on Tuesday, May 25th at 7 p.m. And then both ceremonies, pending no changes or anything, are scheduled to be held at Johnson Coliseum on the Sam Houston State University campus in Huntsville. That being said, anything is subject to change, so we are still perfectly capable of holding two ceremonies at our stadium if need be. And when we met with our leadership students, on both campuses, their number one concern was, I want to get the most people I can get in to see me graduate. I want the most family members I can get. If that's at the stadium, then I want to have it at the stadium. If that's at the Coliseum, I want to have it at the Coliseum. And we feel like the Coliseum is going to be our best shot to get the most people in to see them. And we realize for our seniors, this is the culmination of K through 12, they've worked their whole lives for that, and we really want to honor the accomplishment in a way. So we're working to have it at Johnson Coliseum, but we're prepared to have it here if we have to. And I think the ceremonies we had in the spring were really good ceremonies. I think everybody was positive. At that time, we were just worried we weren't going to have one, and we wanted to have it and honor those kids. And And we've learned a lot and from that time. You know, we could hold it a little different. We won't have to have everyone exit. That was the only negative the last year's ceremony is the last kid that walked across the stage to an empty stadium, pretty much, because we had an exit procedure for that. But we can work around that with the new COVID. And hopefully, by May, we'll have some different rules on that anyway. So, but that's our plan.
And I'm really excited about the ability to move forward with this. We've been in communication with both high school principals and their leadership teams, been having conversations. It's top of mind of our students. They want to know, are we having graduation? Where are we having it? I think several of us really like outside graduations, but we recognize that most people do prefer, for a number of different reasons, inside graduations, and then the ability to have the access to a lot of tickets. It's pretty astounding sometimes how many ticket requests you get from students. As I said to several of you, you know, I was once approached by one student who wanted 200 tickets. I'm not sure I had no 200 people to invite to anything, but some of our students do. So we're excited about this venue. We're excited about not having to put a lot of restrictions currently around COVID. If there were things to change, and if this venue were to come back to us at the last minute and say, we're going to limit capacity, we're going to limit your access to tickets, we're going to do all sorts of things that would take away from the specialness and the ambiance of a graduation, then we're going to do the due diligence to have plan A is to have it at Sam Houston. Plan B will be to have it here at our stadium, and we'll do the work so that if we have to make that pivot quickly, we'll be prepared and ready for our students.
Thank you, Mr. McFadden. All right, our last information item is our monthly financial report. Are there any questions from the board on the monthly financials?
Had one question on the bill to Montgomery for the parade.
Say that again?
The parade fee, did we pay a fee to be in the parade?
Can you tell me what page you're looking at? Oh, gotcha. City of Montgomery.
Yeah, it's got utilities and holiday parade fee.
Yeah, it looks like there was a small $50 fee paid for the...
It's just added on to the larger fee.
Yeah, it's just added on to the utilities.
At first.
Yeah. No, that's a very small, very small amount.
All right.
Any other questions?
Any other questions?
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. The board has already concluded its closed session in a prior meeting, the prior special meeting. So with that, I am going to move to adjourn this meeting at this time.
Well, I want to ask some questions of Dr. Bartlett. So do you mind?
Yeah, sure.
So that leader in me, I'm just sitting here thinking about this the whole time and I'm just astounded by how much you've actually done. So how did you get from, in 3 years, how did you do that?
Dr. Bartlett, can you speak into the microphone? It's because it's being recorded, so.
I'm sorry, I started thinking about this like the minute you moved on to the next thing, so.
You know what, it was a total staff project. And I have to say that this was our staff holiday socially distanced celebration evening, or else they would all be here too, so it's just Kelly and me. But we began with 3 days of training, and so the staff did a Thursday, Friday, Saturday training, and the district let them have off on that Monday. It was the August back to school time, and we talked about, like, you don't want to go to the mall on Saturday in August anyway. You want to go on Monday when no one's there. And so they gave up that Saturday. It was a heavy 3 days, but we had to all be on the same page, because first you have to get trained in the seven habits for yourself so you can live it. You can't teach it if you can't live it. And it was at a critical time when we were opening Kenan and people were transferring, and we were just coming back together as a different staff. We had some changes on our staff. We lost some key people that we were missing, and it just brought everybody together because it gave us a new common verbiage. And our staff got excited. We went to see area schools. There's one other lighthouse school, a Leader Me school that's achieved lighthouse
in our area, but like when I say that, it's by Reliance Stadium. So we went down there and we took like 12, I mean, that's the closest one, so we're kind of excited. So we took 12, 15 staff members. We started taking people down there. Wendy went, Amy went. We went to the school and talked to the kids, and we were like, okay, we could do this. We went to what they call symposiums. It's little short conferences of maybe 2-3 days. I think I probably sent about 25, 30 staff members to those. Wendy came with us on one of them. And so those were in San Antonio. So we'd have a day of training and then a day to go see two schools. And so seeing things in action, it was really great. We reached a point in our second year when staff came and said, don't send us to any more of those because we're better. And it was because we had all those systems in place. Part of the program is we have a coach. And so all of our instructional staff development money, not all, but the majority of our staff development money goes toward paying for that coach. Our PTA helps support too. So that's another reason why it's so important for our community to buy in. But she comes out regularly to meet with us, and we can format that in any way. We can format it with, you know, we need help with just our different action teams with getting, you know, we have one that's focusing on staff development, one that's focusing on student learning, one on family learning. We have 7 different ones. It could be, we just want grade levels to meet with you and talk about how this looks different for kindergarten than it does for fourth grade. So having that coach is great because it takes it off of, we're not the ones saying, here's how it has to be done. You know, we're learning right there alongside them.
And so what does it mean to be a lighthouse school?
It means that we're a model for other schools that want to, that are interested in Leader in Me or that are in the Leader in Me program.
So what's the interest in Leader in Me? Is there an interest, or is there going to be a discussion about interest? And is it should we have interest in Leader in Me as a whole?
Well, I think the great thing is that the reason it was successful at Lone Star was because it was not directed by the principal or the district. The school had an opportunity to look at a program. The school engaged the program together, and it became a shared vision. And when it's a shared vision, it's shared ownership. That's been an important model for us to consider as we embark on our new strategic plan. Because if it's my plan or this board's plan, then it might have some elements and people will say, that's pretty good, I'll follow that, but it will fail miserably unless we had a lot of community support and a lot of collaboration so it becomes the community's plan. And so as part of goal one, which is around academic rigor and academic success for all of our students, those committees are already getting together. We will look at successful innovative models like the Lighthouse Initiative at Lone Star and see which ones are appropriate for replication, and then what are additional programs that we may want to consider at some of our different schools. At the end of the day, there's a push-pull where you want to have consistency, you want to have a common set of expectations for every one of our students, every one of our schools, but how each school gets there and the variety of the instructional program and model that they use is very important. So certainly it's a model that could be replicated in some other schools, but we don't want to say, hey, because it worked at Lone Star, guess what, Stewart Creek, you're going to do it next year. We could do it. It would just be doomed to fail.
So. Well, I mean, I think part of the, I mean, you know, looking at the videos and looking at some of the things you've done, it takes a lot of work to do that. It takes a good leadership to do that. So I think, you know, for me, I've had to roll out programs at large corporations, and it is not easy. And I think to your point, you have to have the right people to roll something like that out and to make it successful. So I think you've done a fantastic job with that. And
isn't one of the habits start with the end in mind?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So yeah.
Well, I've heard that at home. I've had 3 kids go through Lone Star, and I got to tell you, and I meant to call you. We've got a foster child at home that just went from a fourth grade reading level to a sixth grade reading level coming out of Lone Star, and I got to tell you, it happened because of Lone Star. So you know, there's a lot of good things going on. So I just think you're...
Man, I just hire the people. That's all. They're good. That's I just
Dr.
get the...
Dr. Bartlett, you
I mean,
have one
awesome.
Of your colleagues with it. I think most of us know who she is, but can you share?
Yes, this is my fabulous assistant principal, Kelly Lout. Definitely my other half. So we just hire great people. We love them. We love the kids. I was watching this stuff today, and I went in her office, and I was like,
I'm going to tear it up in some of those videos, seeing our kids doing chants and cheers, because that's our school. And, you know, you forget it because we have a new normal and it just doesn't feel like that sometimes. And it's powerful. It's just great to see the kids to take on the leadership roles. That's really it. And once you see that, it's easy for staff to buy in. But it was at a time when we were looking for something to be a little bit different. And, you know, we felt like, gosh, things are so good right now. What can we, you know, we come up with ideas and someone's like, what about if we are the best readers? And we were like, well, we are. I mean, they're great readers. And so anyway, it was student leadership. It was the soft skills. This is what they need, the soft skills.
You're now a lighthouse school. What's next?
Now that we're lighthouse school, now we would like to have some visitors. That's kind of the bummer. You know, I had one principal emailed me and she's like, we're new to Leader in Me and I know you're lighthouse. Can we come and visit? And I was like, give me some dates and we'll see what we can do. I'll have to get all this special approval, but we haven't heard back from them yet. Anyway, that's it. We're looking forward to having visitors again. And there's nothing that our kids love more than sharing all of this with other people. So if you want a tour, they love to give tours. So it's great. But thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Bartlett. So in the spirit of starting with the end in mind, this meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.